That's right, bitches. It's office hours or horas de las oficinas. So inappropriate. So Democratic presidential candidate like mingling the Spanish language. I'm Scott Galloway. This is Office Hours, where we take your questions and then we do a deeper dive with an expert, and then we get very real. And I feel you and you feel me with Algebra of Happiness at the end. So let's kick it up. First off, what's on everyone's mind? The magic that is.
But bounty hunting is a complicated profession.
The Mandalorian. Oh my God, the streaming wars are kind of over before it's even started. This show is fantastic. And my theory is that putting helmets and makeup on everybody reduces their currency and their leverage to demand salaries such that they can put the money back into production values and have all these incredibly awesome monsters and special effects and spaceships and generally just awesome shit off of what is the best franchise in the history of entertainment, Star Wars. Anyways, long story short, before we get to our first question, watch The Mandalorian. It is just wonderful and fantastic. Congratulations to Disney and Disney Plus that have already signed up 10 million members. Enough of that. Our first question from Office Hours.
Hey, Scott. Big dog. Darius from London here. Question. If you're a startup and your prior lead investor wants to smoke its own supply in the new round, should you try to prevent it? And how easily can you without any fallout?
Okay, so thank you, Darius. London is actually becoming a new epicenter for startups based on world-class universities, and that is they have a few outstanding universities, and then they have a shit ton of great universities. Whereas in the U.S., we have 20 amazing universities, the best in the world, and it kind of falls off a map. And we've decided anyone who doesn't get into a top 20 school is not worthy of Chipotle and a nice home in San Francisco or New York. But that's another podcast. Anyways, that wasn't your question. Your question was about an investor who wants to lead follow-on rounds. So look, this is a good problem for you, and that is, to a certain extent, if your lead investor wants to step up and do the next round, your job at the end of the day as a CEO is to make sure there's money in the bank, or one of your first jobs. And so, yeah, it would be nice to have another outside lead. It would be nice to have people participate. But your job is to kind of selfishly protect your own dilution. And not only that, spend less time raising money, which in and among itself doesn't add any value to the consumer experience, your customer experience. So look, if your previous investors are willing to put up a term sheet at a good valuation and you can cash a check and move on, then by all means, cash a check and move on. Now, does that mean your company isn't getting probably maybe an artificially high, or if you haven't done a market check, an artificially low valuation? Maybe. The point is, subsequent rounds done by the same investor lead to I don't want to call it a false number, but a number that may not reflect the market. But as a CEO, bottom line, this is the question you ask. Should you let an investor leads subsequent rounds? Yeah, if you can get back to work and it's a good valuation, you're happy with it, cash a check and move on. And congratulations, what you call a good problem. A good problem. Am I more handsome or am I more charming? That is the big issue at the doghouse. And again, that's a good problem. Next question.
Hey, Professor Galloway. I wanted to know what you think about Oyo as a franchise business. Which is essentially what they paint themselves as opposed to a REIT. Do you think they compare more towards management companies or actually brand and franchises like Marriott or Hyatt or Hilton?
Thanks for that. So Oyo is this unicorn SoftBank-backed startup out of India that is trying to roll up franchise or roll up budget hotels and put them all on a platform to reduce the cost of customer acquisition, make some CapEx investments so they can turn a shitty hotel into a less shitty hotel, and then create, I don't know if they're trying to create a global brand or if it's more about just customer acquisition, or they see an opportunity to roll these things up inexpensively. It looks to me like a franchise model, not a REIT. Now, having said that, I think there are some red flags here, and that is, we did some research into this. They bought the Hooters Casino in Las Vegas for $135 million. And if you're buying properties that went for $54 million 4 years ago for $135, that to me is an indicator that you might be overpaying for some of your assets. I'm an ageist. I don't think 75-year-olds make good CEOs of tech companies, nor do I think a 25-year-old does. There's actually some interesting research showing that the cohort or the age group that has the greatest hit rate in entrepreneurship is actually in their 50s, believe it or not. Also, some other red flags. Lightspeed Ventures and Sequoia Capital, both incredibly great firms with a lot of smart people, are getting the hell out of Dodge. They've sold 50% of their stake for $1.5 billion. And what's scary about this is the people that know the company best, the people that have access to the numbers, the people that get to see the body language of the CEO. One of the things a venture capital firm will do as a function or something they get in exchange for their investment is they get what's called pro rata rights for future investments, meaning if they own 10% of the company, they get 10% of any future round. And they negotiate hard for that. And the fact that they're not only not exercising their pro rata rights, but deciding to sell shares, meaning that a couple of the parties here that know this company better than certainly any of us have decided not only to not continue investing, but sell at the current valuation it's not only a sell signal, it's a red flag. SoftBank's been a lead investor in every round since 15 against smoking their own supply. And the reviews on the platform, the user reviews, are really shitty. So what is this? I think we should have a new term, and that is incinerators. Trademark Scott Galloway. Incinerators. That is companies that have a lot of growth, very low gross margins, and a drunken, cheap source of capital. And they start literally incinerating billions of dollars. And that's Uber. That's obviously WeWork. And it could be Oyo. So in sum, I think Oyo is a franchise model, but worse, I think Oyo might be our next incinerator. Mysterious! Mysterious and sexy while talking about business. Next question.
Hey, it's Ian from Sydney. Love your work, mate. You've sold your last business, and I'm guessing you've got enough cash to just sit around a swimming pool and eat special edibles full time, but you've just started this new thing. How long do you plan to keep working for, and why?
Ian, another sexy beast. What's with all the accents? You and I need a Foster's and to go to the Polar Club on Bondi Beach? Anyways, I love Australia. So why keep working? I ask myself this a lot. I'm blessed. I got very lucky. And it's not a humble brag. I really do believe I got lucky. And I probably don't need to work again, at least not for economic reasons. The first reason I started another business was just reflex memory. This time it was different, though. It's hard. I think entrepreneurship is a young man's game. This one's been hard for me. I'm at an age where I have kids who are at a great age. I'm trying to take more stock of life, trying to slow down a bit. And companies are like infants. They require your every breathing moment of attention or they die. I had an idea about a streaming MBA company, and I thought there's an opportunity to offer kind of 30 or 50% of the value of an MBA for, 1, 2, or 3% of the price. I think education is just ripe to be disrupted. It stuck its chin out, raising prices so crazily fast and above inflation that I think there's just a big opportunity. And for lack of a better term, what we're doing here at Section 4, trying to be a streaming MBA. Also, just from a health standpoint, being mentally engaged keeps you alive. I ask myself the same question you asked me in, but one, I want relevance. Two, I think I have something to say. Three, I have a group of people, young people that I work with that are exceptional. Anyways, thanks for the thoughtful question, but the answer is I ask myself that every day. Next up, our contributor, our markets contributor, the inimitable Josh Brown. Josh Brown, the CEO of Ritholtz Wealth Management, founded by a friend, Barry Ritholtz. Let's bust right into it. So your job is to obviously be cognizant of the markets, but if you're, say you're in your 20s or in your 30s and you're trying to build a portfolio, build a nest egg,
yeah,
hard to time the markets. Talk about the relationship or talk about how you approach investing. Are you trying to find, for lack of a better term, macro trends across markets and then diversify and play the upswing? Or are you looking for dislocation in individual stocks?
No, we don't actually believe in macro themes, or it's not that we don't accept that they exist. It's that we don't think we have an edge on predicting them, timing them. We also don't believe that anyone else can either, but that's a whole other conversation. We serve three different constituencies of investors. The first and primary are people somewhere in the middle of their life that have accumulated a lot of assets.
Yep.
And we've got to do an equally good job at both protecting and growing those assets.
Yep.
And we're not doing it based on market forecasts. What we're actually using as our guideline is the client's life, the priorities that they've stated to us in advance that are important to them.
Yep.
So in some cases, it's a second home. In some cases, it's funding college. A lot of our clients have north of $10 million in assets. They won't spend it in their lifetime. Mm-hmm. They're thinking about what happens with it afterward. And again, that's the primarily the client base. But then we've got clients who are in what's called decumulation, distribution. Mm-hmm. They're spending now.
Yep.
So these are people in their 70s and 80s.
Yep.
And they are literally funding their lifestyle based on the portfolio. So you would agree with me, Scott, you're not investing in the same way
right.
for those two groups. Now we've got a third group of investors who are under 40. Mm-hmm. Myself, I'm 42, so I invest in...
So you pretend you're under 40, like every 42-year-old dude.
I'm very close. But we're investing in much, I'm investing in much the same way as this group of clients. Yeah. They are in the phase that's called accumulation.
Right.
And for them, so it's hard for me making content and talking about markets because for them, mm-hmm. nothing would be better mm-hmm. than a lost decade for stocks. Because that would give them 10 years to accumulate positions in the markets. So from 2000 to 2009, the S&P 500 was flat.
Right.
You made some money in REITs. You did well in bonds. Made some money in emerging market stocks. But American stocks, mm-hmm. nothing. It was a fantastic period for people who were, let's say, Gen X. Mm-hmm. They were earning money. Every 2 weeks, a portion of their paycheck went into a 401k.
Yep.
They may not have felt great about it. But that enabled them to accumulate. And then in 2013, you finally make a new high above the 2007 high prior to the crisis.
Right.
And it's been all upside from there on out. And these people had that benefit of that lost decade where they bought and bought and bought. If you're under 40 right now, if you're in the millennial cohort,
yep.
and you've got a good paying job and you can afford to invest excess capital, assuming you have excess money, and you're doing the right thing with your retirement account, you should not be cheering for new fucking highs. Why yep. would you? Why would you want to buy at increasing valuations like mm-hmm. this? So how do you speak to both groups?
Right.
So you have one group that are our clients. They're 65 years old. Retirement is within 5 years, and they know they're going to start drawing down from the.
They must start selling. Yeah.
They don't want to hear about a lost decade would be great. Not yeah. for them, yeah. but for their children who are 31 and working at a law firm and
in a decade they'll be lost, i.e. dead.
Right. So that's my challenge. Don't yeah. feel bad for me. It's fine. I'm pretty yeah. good at it. But you know, different cohorts of investors should be rooting for different outcomes mm-hmm. in the markets. And I think that gets lost in the media because the media is trying to talk to everyone all at once. And it's really hard to do.
Talk about some of the consumer IPOs. Give us a sense of what's happened in the IPO market in 19.
So I think what's happened is this is the year Wall Street called bullshit on the valley
mm-hmm.
Or the alley.
Right.
And it's a long time coming. It's really interesting to me because for my entire career, we have always heard that private markets were the smart money
mm-hmm.
and public markets were the dumb money. This was the year where that paradigm was flipped on its head.
Yep.
Now, I don't think what I'm saying is that private markets are dumb. I guess what I'm saying is they thought the public was dumber than it really is. So I actually don't think WeWork is the seminal moment of this.
Mm-hmm.
I think Uber was.
100%.
And yeah. I have said that Adam Neumann would have been fine had he beaten Uber to the public market.
They would have got out.
Well, nobody was reading S1s until that yeah. blew up.
100%. When Uber got out, And we saw a destruction in what, $40 or $50 billion registered by the public market.
Sick.
And we saw a negative margin company get out. They breached the firewall and everyone decided, you know, we're not going to get burned again.
Now imagine you're a wealth management client
yep.
of JP Morgan or Morgan Stanley. I'm not picking on anyone specifically.
Yep.
So Scott Galloway has X number of dollars with one of these firms. And they came to you in the spring and they said, we'll give you Lyft.
Right.
You're thrilled. You're getting the VIP treatment.
Yeah.
I got into Lyft.
Into an IPO.
My friends couldn't, right? You go tell your friends you could play golf with or whatever. So that doesn't work out so well.
Right.
And then they come back to you and they say, okay, we're going to make it up to you, Uber. It was only a couple months later. We can only get you 300 shares of Uber, but you can flip it immediately.
Right.
So you say, all right, my guy's taking care of me.
Yeah.
So now that blows up. It opened at it traded at 44. I think it was 41 a day later. So now they come back to you with WeWork, and you say, "Fuck you!
I've had it.
It's enough. I'm not an idiot anymore."
Josh, so let me just share this story. So when I sold my company, I got pitched by every, you know, wealth management company in the world, right? And to their credit, Goldman invested early and often in me. They started grooming me well before I sold my company, invested a lot of time, smart people. It always struck me that they had an analyst. They were saying, they had told WeWork that they were going out at 60 to 80 billion. And if the smartest people in the room, the Goldman equity analyst for internet stocks or whatever you would call this thing, said this thing's going out at 60 to 80, and it's reportedly pricing at 47 billion, well, you as an asset, or you as a client of our asset management, congratulations, we're going to get you stock in WE. Yeah. And the public markets would have registered that 90% decline. It feels like the private markets, and tell me if you agree with this, people will fill in niches to try and make money. To say this thing was worth $50 billion, if Goldman was going to put up an analyst, I mean, are these guys really fiduciaries for us?
No, but they don't claim to be. They're brokers. They sell stocks. They're not giving advice.
Well, aren't they giving advice when they put out buy ratings on these guys?
No.
You don't think so?
No, actually, they've been lobbying and spending tens of millions of dollars every year, maybe more, to explain to Congress that they ought not be held to a fiduciary standard. They are the sellers of financial instruments who sometimes give advice in the course of that process of salesmanship. What they prefer is what's called a suitability standard, which has gotten a makeover. Now they're calling it best interests standard. But they do not want to be held to a fiduciary standard. And I get it. They can't be. Mm-hmm. How could you represent Adam Neumann as a private client, let him borrow against his shares and give him all the liquidity he wants to do whatever he wants? And then, so that's with your left hand. With your right hand, you're working on an offering for those shares to the public.
Yeah.
With your other right hand, you're selling a debt issue for them.
Yeah.
And then with your other left hand, you have wealth management clients who you're going to sell that stock to.
Yeah.
And those debt instruments to. So who are you the fiduciary to?
But that's what they're doing.
And I get it. That's their business. But how can you be a fiduciary to all four or five of those parties that I just listed if they're in a transaction together? It'd be like you and I are gonna get divorced and we have the same lawyer. Are you fucking kidding me? So
they're on the buy and the sell.
Right. So now if you're a wealth management client, ask yourself where you fit into that hierarchy and stop being a schmuck. You know you're not as important to the bank as the investment banking fees they're getting for the IPO. You have to know that. If you don't know that, that's a robo client.
So you're saying the delta is, or the kind of the inefficiency here, is guys like me take their equity analyst research buy rating seriously, and I shouldn't.
You should stop doing that.
It's pure marketing.
Yeah.
And maybe use it for education, but when the Goldman analysts who—
Scott, I think they're trying.
Yeah?
I don't think that they're trying to bullshit people. I really don't. Yeah. And there are some firewalls in place. They call it a Chinese wall. The fight that Elliot Spitzer waged against Wall Street in the wake of the dot-com crisis was exactly what you're describing. Henry Blodgett, who's a friend of mine, Henry Blodgett was writing research reports for the retail client of Merrill Lynch.
Right.
He's basically saying, this stock is worth 30 points higher than where it trades now, and here's my whole justification. After hitting send on that research report, the next thing he writes is an email to his boss saying, I can't believe we're doing this shit.
Yeah, but crap.
This is garbage.
Yeah.
Okay. So Spitzer got $1 billion settlement out of Wall Street. By the way, that used to be a big number.
Right.
But Spitzer got $1 billion from Wall Street, and not just a monetary fine. They ended up coming up with all these new rules where the analyst had to certify their opinion, and the bankers couldn't be in bed with the analyst because Blodgett wasn't the worst. Mm-hmm. There were guys at Smith Barney. There were guys at other firms who were getting paid on the IPO.
Mm-hmm.
Or getting shares of the IPO. Can you imagine? I'm writing research on a telecom thing, and I'm getting shares of it on the side.
Yeah.
So that was supposed to have changed. But the truth is, we're talking about human nature.
Sure.
And you can't change human nature. So the banks are going to give preferential treatment to whoever is paying them the most.
100%.
And it doesn't mean every IPO is bad.
Yeah.
And it doesn't mean the analysts are bad. It's just like you have to wake up.
Josh Brown, CEO of Ritholtz Asset Management. Thanks very much. That- That's right. Algebra of happiness. And the reason we need to call it the calculus of happiness is that I was a math whiz as an 8-year-old. Me and Debbie Brubaker were sent to the 5th grade, even though we were only in the 3rd grade for math and English. And I could do math in my head and was supposed to be the next kind of big math prodigy. And then I hit in the 8th grade calculus, and that was the end of that. Enough about me. Enough about me. Algebra of happiness. I'm at an age where a lot of wonderful things are happening. And that is kids, perspective, some professional accomplishment, an appreciation for friendships. You know, a lot of wonderful things about being my age. I'm 47, 55, actually. I just turned 55, but I'm now lying about my age. But the unfortunate thing, or one of the really upsetting things, is that not a lot, but more than you'd like to think of, my friends are dying. I've had 2 friends. One was a casual friend who was struggling with lung cancer for the last decade pass away. And I found out last week that a college roommate is struggling with throat cancer. The good news, the type of cancer is very treatable, and he'll likely be fine. And they say that your 20s and 30s are actually your unhappiest times in your life. There's an arc of happiness. And the reason why is that when you're in your 20s and 30s, kind of death is unimaginable. You just can't even contemplate it. And then somebody you love inevitably gets sick and dies, whether it's a grandparent or a parent. And life kind of, or the harshness of life, and let's be honest, there's a very harsh aspect of life, hits you square in the face. And what was shocking for me is I wasn't expecting to have people in my life or people in my peer group die. And I think one of the, there's a couple of reasons it rattles you. One, you're just sad for them and their families and you're going to miss them. But 2, it also really scares the shit out of you as you recognize that, okay, if people your age are dying, it means you could die. And I'm reminded of one of the few truisms that I've always held on to. Nothing's ever as good as it seems. When you're killing it, when you're doing well, when you're making money, when you're doing really well at work, I think it's important to remember a lot of it isn't your fault. And that is a lot of it's luck, a lot of it's timing, a lot of it's being in the right place at the right time, being fortunate enough to be involved with a great organization, or being fortunate enough to be the right age and the right economy in the right country, being fortunate enough to have senior level sponsorship at an organization, being fortunate enough to have a platform to demonstrate and highlight how good you are at something. All these things are just really good fortune. And it's important to recognize how fortunate you are and have some level of humility to try and not only pay it forward, but also, I would say, become a little less risk aggressive. And that is, for example, whenever I've had a great year in the stock market, I tend to believe, oh, I should lever up and buy more stocks because I'm a fucking genius in the markets. And typically the markets then promptly remind me, no, that I'm not a genius. At the same time, nothing's ever as bad as it seems. And that is when you get fired, when you have a failed relationship, when you screw up and you do something at work that's stupid. It's probably not entirely your fault either. And that is, in 1999, when I was a fucking genius and supposedly a billionaire and looking in jets, no, I wasn't a genius. But in 2001 and then in 2000 again, in 2008, when I wasn't broke, but I was financially stressed or in a position or a place that I didn't think I would be at that age, given all the risk and limited success I recognized, I wasn't the idiot the markets thought I was either. You know, things weren't as bad as they seem. And I think the key, or one of the keys to success, is when something bad happens to you is mourning for a little while, but put a statute of limitations on your mourning. You get fired, feel sorry for yourself for a couple weeks, and then get to the good work of reaching out to people and getting on LinkedIn and finding another job. When you make a bad investment decision, try and learn from it, and then just move on. Relationships, et cetera. Even for me, when my mom passed away, I should have put more of a statute of limitations on it and said, all right, 6 months, and then if I'm still not doing well, I need to seek help. And I woke up 2 years later and realized I was still kind of depressed and rattled about my mom's death and decided to get some help. So nothing's ever as good or as bad as it seems. Life isn't about what happens to you. It's about how you react to what happens to you. Everybody knows failure. Everybody knows tragedy. It's not as bad as it seems. And everybody knows success. Everybody knows victory. And quite frankly, it's not as good as it seems. All right, here we are. We're going to sign off from Algebra of Happiness. And what do we have? We are bringing you members of the London Symphony who started a band that was supposed to be the heir to the Beatles. Beautiful ballads, poetic lyrics. That's right, Electric Light Orchestra. What is the key message here? Regardless of what happens to you today, don't let it bring you down. Do you live somewhere beautiful? Do you have people in your life that love you? Are you in good shape? Do you have health? Do you have the opportunity to love others? Then there is no reason, bitches, to be down. Whatever happens today, don't let it bring you down. The dog is thinking about you. Have a wonderful day. We will speak to you next week.